my love. There's only you in my life, the only thing that's right.
My first love, your every breath that I take, your every step I make.
Hearts that beat as one, our lives have just begun.
He called her on the road from a lonely cold hotel room just to hear her say, I love you one more time. And when he heard the sound of the kids laughing in the background, he had to wipe away a tear from his eye. little voice came on the phone. He said, Daddy, when you come home. He said the first thing that came to his mind, I'm already there. Take a look around. I'm the sunshine in your hair. I'm the shadow on the ground. I'm the whisper in the wind. I'm your imaginary friend. And I know I'm in your prayers. Oh, I'm already there. She got back on the phone. Said, I really miss you, darling. Don't worry about the kids, they'll be alright. Wish I was in your arms, lying right there beside you. But I know that I'll be in your dreams tonight. And I'll gently kiss your lips, touch you with my fingertips. So turn out the light and close your eyes. I'm already there. Don't make a sound. I'm the beat in your heart. I'm the moonlight shining down. I'm the whisper in the wind. And I'll be there till the end. Can you feel the love that we share? Sunshine in your hair. I'm the shadow on the ground. I'm the whisper in the wind. And I'll be there till the end. Can you feel the love that we share? Oh, I'm already there. Oh, I'm
My dear brother, it's time to say goodbye. You have fought a courageous battle, and now it's time for you to go on to your new adventure. I'll not think of you as gone, but see you in everything, as part of everything. I love you, and I'll miss you more than I have words to say. As I look back at the pictures of my life, I see your smiling face in each. You've helped me through so many moments, and it'll be hard now to realize I'll never hear that "Hey, Miss" again. I love you, Wayne, and I'll miss you.
When I think of Wayne Yeargain, I think of a very big man. And when I say big man, I don't mean as in obese or big-headed. I'm talking about big in spirit, big in servanthood, big heart, and a big love for his family. Wayne and I go back to even before Rachel Yeargain was born. And Leela and Wayne and I watched our kids grow up together. I know that God is saying to Wayne, "One great job, my faithful servant." Not only in his family life, but his servanthood to his church, to his friends, and to even total strangers. Go rest high, Wayne. Love you.
What can I say about Uncle Wayne that anybody that's ever met him doesn't already know? He was a loving, caring, special, smart man. He loved his wife tremendously. He loved his daughter to no end. First time I heard cool beans came from Uncle Wayne. He has a huge heart. He's a very special man. He will be truly missed. I love you, Uncle Wayne.
Wayne Mark, just thinking about you, I have many great memories, fun memories. And what Sylvia thinks of Wayne is quite a lot. You know, you are quite a man. You are an awesome husband, an excellent father. And I know God thinks you're a great son. You have been an awesome husband. If I had a son, you are a man that I would not mind him being in the presence of. You are honest, you know, and always thoughtful of what someone else could possibly be feeling, which when I first met you, I found that surprising, but it's a good surprise, you know. The way you have treated, taken care of, kept, looked out for your family, kudos. Being a believer and seeing your walk with God and your walk in this life has truly been something to watch. I heard different comments from your wife about you in a good way. You know, Wayne, no way Wayne is gonna do or say, and I found that to be true. I really did, but you are the epitome of what I think a person should be and how they act and walk and talk this life. I look forward to continuing to be in your life, always and forever praying for you in your absence from your family and when you were back here with your family. Your daughter has a place in her heart for you, as she should. That's different than many. I think we all take for granted, you know, your children love your parents, because you take care of them, things like that. but that relationship you guys have from boating out on the water couldn't be copied. She has enjoyed it. She's spoken on it at different times. So I know it meant a lot to her. And I'm sure you know that, but I just want you to know again from me, as someone meeting you guys in the past 12 years, that that did mean a lot to her. It was important, and obviously will continue to be important to her as she is a newlywed now and getting a life of her own as far as being married and living away and these type things. I have every faith in her with the faith that she has in you, first of all, because both of you call on the name of Jesus of leading and guiding your lives. I cannot imagine what it feels like to have a child that is married to a believer. If that is not number one, I don't know what is. I am thankful and grateful for that, for her and for you guys, because to me, that is a peace that you can have as far as her life is concerned. I thank God for you. I thank God for Leela, and I thank God for Rachel. Glad to be in your life and will stay in your life. And you know what that means by staying in your life. I'm so glad that we all are believers, therefore we'll never truly have to be without each other. Love you, Wayne Mark. Out, Sylvia.
Go.
Hello, big fella. Just a few things to say to your partner. Glad to see a big Marine come in when you did. You know you're my brother. I like the way that you, the things that when we ask you, things that we didn't know how to do around the house, I'm glad that you was able to come over and do these things for us. And even though you didn't ask for pay, I felt like I had to give you something. I like the way you stepped in and taught Bible study whenever you were home. Also, I just ask you, I appreciate your candor, whatever you said, what you had on your mind, and you meant it. And you were never anyone that would downplay what anybody else had to do. But you would correct somebody if they were doing something wrong. And I all of those things I admire about you. And again, I'm still praying for you, big fella. And we will continue to pray for you and your family.
What I think about my dad, he was amazing. He did everything for my mom. He set the bar really, really high. He was a leader. He was respected. And I'm gonna miss him so much. But God has a plan. And when I miss him the most, I'll be at the water's edge, because that was our thing. We did water stuff together, and that's where I feel him the most. I can see him in my eyes when I look in the mirror. I love you, Daddy.
Dreamed I went to heaven, and you were there with me. We walked upon the streets of gold beside the crystal sea. We heard the angels singing, and someone called your name. We turned and saw this young man, and he was smiling as he came. And he said, friend, you may not know me now. And then he said, but wait. You used to teach my Sunday school when I was only 8. And every week you would say a prayer before the class would start. And one day when you said that prayer, I asked Jesus in my heart. Changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. Then another man stood before you and said, remember the time a missionary came to your church. His pictures made you cry. You didn't have much money, but you gave it anyway. Jesus took the gift you gave, and that's why I'm here today.
Thank you for giving to the Lord. Was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave.
One by one they came, far as the eye could see. Each life somehow touched by your generosity. Little things that you had done, sacrifices made, unnoticed on the earth, in heaven now proclaimed. And I know up in heaven you're not supposed to cry. But I am almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you, for great is your reward. Giving to the Lord, for I am a life that was changed.
Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so
Would you stand, please, in honor of the reading of Scripture? That was a beautiful video. Well done. What a tribute. God bless you. When I was thinking about this homegoing service for Wayne, I thought of Romans chapter 8 on these victory verses, picking it up in verse 35 and following. I know many of you know it, but listen again, as it applies to the great and glorious victory that is ours in Christ Jesus. Inspired by the Holy Spirit, Paul said, "Who can separate us from the love of Christ? Can affliction or anguish or persecution or famine or nakedness or the danger of the sword, as it is written, because of you we are being put to death all day long. We are counted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than victorious through him who loves us. For I am persuaded that not even death or life or angels or rulers, things present or things to come, hostile powers, height or depth, or any other created thing will have the power to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Heavenly Father, we give you praise today for the glorious victory, for the knowledge, the knowing that our dear brother, your servant Wayne Yeargain, stands in your glorious presence, very much alive, from here to eternity. We thank you for the glorious victory of the gospel. Father, that's ours, all of us who placed our faith and trust in your eternal Son, our Savior. For that, we celebrate a life today, not only a life that was here in this world, but Wayne's life that continues even as I speak, in glory. In Jesus' name, we rejoice. Amen. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. I want to personally say to our whole family, church family, and friends, it is an honor to be able to have a part here in this tribute, this homegoing for Brother Wayne. He went home to be with the Lord after 59 years this side of heaven, and his lifespan will continue now on into eternity, as it is for all of us that are gathered here that have placed our faith in him, our Lord Jesus. Wayne was born in Honolulu, Hawaii, born to Wayne and Anna May Yeargain on May 14th, 1960. Went home on November 28th here just a few days ago. Thank the Lord. I know all of you that are gathered here and some that could not make it certainly would want to be here. We thank God for this man's life and the way he profoundly touched each of us, as given proof by that video and the testimonies there. His life, this side of heaven, is going to be long remembered. He was a Marine. And once a Marine, always a Marine. Right, Paul? And he certainly acted the same spirit of what it meant to be a Marine, carrying that over into his Christian life, in his duty and service to his church here at Myrtle Grove Baptist. He was preceded in homegoing by his mother, Anna Mae Everlane. And Wayne leaves with his memory cherished by his wife, Leland. What a tremendous couple you guys have been and are. I say present tense are, because you're going to be with your precious Wayne again in glory. His daughter, Rachel, and husband, Daniel, you put together a beautiful tribute to your father. That was wonderful. God bless you, sweetie. He loved you so much and loves you so much. His father, Wayne Yeargain, and his wife, Julie, siblings, Mike Yeargain, Joe Yeargain, his wife, Katina, Dominique Smith, husband, Tom, his daughter, Dominique, and David Yeargain, wife, Chris, along with 8 nieces, 5 nephews, 4 great nephews, 5 great nieces, 2 great-great nieces, and 1 great-great nephew, and a host of relatives and friends. That is one big family. God bless you. You know, to all of you, may I say, at this part in the homegoing here in the beginning, something I always say to surviving family members this side of heaven: may the peace that Christ spoke about, that those outside of our Lord know nothing about, only a Christian, a follower of Jesus, can know it. May God's peace, that eternal immeasurable, I mean glorious peace that transcends our finite mind, our ability to understand, especially in times when we have to let go of someone this side of heaven, the eternal peace of God. May that peace bring comfort to your hearts and your mind, knowing that you will, through faith in Jesus, see Wayne again. Shana Saul, beautiful voice, wonderful young lady, is going to come now, and she's going to share a song in honor of Brother Wayne.
Is it on? Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on that cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
thank you. God bless you. Beautiful, beautiful. Indeed, this is certainly a celebration time, a celebration of life. One of the things that Wayne enjoyed was praise and worship music. And, I mean, all the songs, he and Leela both. And coming to lead in that time is Isaac Richardson. Isaac, some of you may know, was the son of Pastor Riley Richardson here at the Myrtle Grove United Methodist Church, a good friend and brother of our church family here, the whole family. Isaac, come now, if you would, and the friends that you've got with you that will lead in this time. They'll be doing two songs here and one a little bit later on. Come at this time, gentlemen.
I forgot that part. Good morning. I'm so glad to be able to be here. We're actually going to start out this worship with a song called He Reigns. We'll be starting with that song. if you would all please stand as we worship this morning. I was told that the worship music that was requested was meant to be upbeat and excited, and I completely agree with wanting that, because what better way to acknowledge how great God is in somebody's life than to be excited for God? I know for a fact that Wayne is excited to see God. I did not know him personally, but I can guarantee you from everything that I've heard about him that he is enjoying heaven right now, and God is enjoying heaven with him. So we're going to sing He Reigns this morning.
A grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns. He let it rise above the four winds, caught up in the heavenly sound. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Bought songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none ring as true as this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah. He reigns, he reigns. It's all God's 'Cause all the power of darkness can't drown out a single word. When all God's people sing that glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns, He reigns. All God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns. Children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns.
This next song is about the lion and the lamb. It's a beautiful song. It's just about the power of God, and God is a powerful God. So the bridge, it goes, who can stop the Lord Almighty? There's absolutely nothing that can stop Him, and He's going to continue working in every single one of our lives on a daily basis. And I can assure you that He's coming for us, and He's going to bring heaven to earth, and it's going to be absolutely beautiful. So we're going to sing this song. We're going to get upbeat. We're going to get excited, and we're going to praise God this morning, because that's what we're here for.
Chain will break, His broken hearts declare His praise. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb, the Lamb that was slain. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before Him.
The Lord Almighty. Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 Oh, who
guess I'm the Lord Almighty. Oh, guess I'm the Lord Almighty. Oh, guess I'm the Lord. Our God is a lion, the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power in fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is a lamb, the lamb that was slain. Sins of the world, His blood branches. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before
Him. I'm just gonna sing this bridge. Real quick, just lift your voice real quick.
Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, who can stop the Lord singing over the battle? Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, who can stop the Lord Almighty? Oh, who can stop the Lord?
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. This time, I believe Rachel has a tribute she'd like to read about her dad. Rachel, if you'll come.
Okay, so I wrote this without crying, so I'm going to try to read this without crying. We're going to see how this goes. But I want to read my mom's first, mostly because without them I wouldn't be here. But without them, I wouldn't know the Lord. So I would like to read theirs first. And I'm going to try. I make no promises. The unity of three. When two hearts beat as one, they became a unit. Yet when two hearts beat as one through the unity of Christ, untold adventures explode and lead to uncharted waters that are beyond human understanding. That was my marriage. An adventure. Wayne made me laugh. He held me when I cried. He built a kingdom under the leadership of the Lord. He kept me grounded during our struggles, and he was my rock. He made my dreams come true. He could always brighten up my day. Sometimes it was lunch or flowers. Other times, and most of the time, it was eventful life moments, like a glass coffee table, a cat tree, and Shay and him. Playing just a little too rough. He gave me everything, not things, but memory. Love, compassion, respect. He gave me things that matter the most, things that money can't buy. He gave so much to others, but I never felt like I took a back seat. I felt blessed by his willingness to help others. We worked together, and now he's on to his next chapter, the final chapter. But he never really left me. He's always there. I can hear his voice in daily decisions or hear his laughter when I smile. He may be with the Lord, but he'll always be in my heart. And since I struggle with that one, I'm going to struggle with mine. From a daughter's heart. There's so many things that I could say about my father. We had fun together. We went hiking, sailing, canoeing. We read books. We played games. He was my partner in crime. I can even remember trips to Walmart when Mom would say that it was enough children because we were goofing off too much. That happened more times than I want to admit. But I remember when he sold insurance, and I was excited about being able to ride around with him. Yeah, as a parent, his mindset was I need to provide. But I thought it was cool, and it was an adventure. Yet when he began working offshore, my whole world changed, and I didn't understand. But I do now. By doing the things that he did, by spending the time with me and providing, he set the bar really high. He showed me what a father should do. He showed me how a husband provides for his family. God first, family second, and others third. He did so much for us and so much for others. He was a man of honesty and integrity and respect, but he was a godly man above all else. I pray that my father had no regrets. In the movie Courageous, the main character, Adam Mitchell, had a regret because he didn't dance with his daughter. But mine did. And I will treasure those moments because he did it in every way that he could. He honored the Lord, and he raised me, and he loved his wife. He was a man of faith, and he never looked down on others. Now he's with the Lord. And while I'm like both, I notice more and more of my father in me. He taught me how to defend those who won't defend themselves. He honored the Lord, he fought the good fight, and I'm proud to be his daughter. And out of my mother, who is a true Proverbs 31 woman. This isn't easy. And some days I don't know what to say or what to tell you. But the victory belongs to the Lord, and by his strength, not yours. But through him, together, we will get through this. You and Daddy taught me that moments like this is when the faith matters the most. It's in our darkest hour and our brightest days that we take heart and we serve him faithfully and have faith. I cannot think of any other better way to honor my father than to honor the values that y'all taught me. I will miss my father to no end, but I will honor the man that protected my heart over the years by living a worthy life. For those of you that have kids, pray for them, love them, teach them right from wrong. Teach them those values. If you're a father or want to be one, be a courageous man, because that will speak the most. I don't care about money or things, but what I value and I treasure most are the things that y'all say about my father. Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel. I know a lot of the tributes, there were several in the video that was shown earlier, folks that spoke about what Wayne had meant to their life. We have time now to hear from another, and then possibly others who'd like to share just a testimony of Wayne's impact on your life. But first, Jim Gramlich is going to come and share about his friend. Jim?
Does it get any better than how great thou art? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? And then a daughter standing up there and giving a testimony of a father who loved her with all his heart and loved his wife. I mean, I don't think it gets any better than that, guys. But I have two short stories, very, very short, to tell about Wayne. And I was only alone with Wayne twice in my life, one-on-one. And these two stories have to deal with that. The first one was about 2 years ago. I asked Wayne if he wanted to go fishing. He said, sure. So we went, I picked him up and everything, and then I didn't have any bait. So I'm driving down the road, and I got near Joe Patty's, and I said, Wayne, we need to go in here and get some bait, because I don't have any bait at all. And he says, no problem. So we go in there, and I started to get out of the car, and he says, no, Jim, let me do this. And I said, okay, Wayne. So he said, what do I get? I said, just go in there and get 1 pound of the cheapest shrimp you can find, whatever. And he says, okay. So he goes in, and he seemed like he was in there just for a long, long, long time. And finally, he comes out with his bag and a big smile on his face and everything. And he gets in the car, and I said, what took you so long? He said, well, I just had to pick out just the right ones. I said, Wayne, just the cheapest, remember? The cheapest. So we get out on the boat, and we get under the Bay Bridge, and I open this up, and Wayne buys headless, deveined shrimp. And they were 12 count, which means he only had 12 shrimp. And I look at him, I said, what are you doing? And he said, well, I wanted to get the best. You know, I wanted to get the best to make sure we catch the best fish. I said, Wayne, you cut off all the good stuff, all the stuff the fish like to eat, you cut off. But that's the Wayne I know. Wayne was like that. He always went above and beyond, and he tried to do better. And that's the Wayne that I'll always remember. The second story was about a month and a half ago. And I called Wayne up, and I said, Wayne, would you like to go to breakfast together? Just me and you. Because normally Wayne would send a text out to guys in our church, and he would say, hey, I'm meeting at Denny's, let's go over there. And Wayne did that all the time, right? But this one time, I just wanted to ask Wayne some real personal questions. So I picked him up, and he had his walker. He was still walking around pretty good. And I took him to this little restaurant that I go to called CJ's. And we got in there, and Wayne looks at me and says, well, what do you want to talk about? You know, what do you need, Jim? I said, well, Wayne, I said, I really don't want to be too personal with you, but I would appreciate it if I could just ask you some real personal questions today. And he said, you can ask me anything you want, Jim, anything. So I looked at him and I said, Wayne, unless God heals you, it looks like you're going to be going to heaven pretty soon. And he looked at me and he said, yeah, he said, that's probably true, Jim. He said, what do you want to ask me? And I said, well, what's most important to you right now, Wayne? What is the most important thing in your life? And Wayne, I don't know if some of you know this, but Wayne is a chess player. And he thinks a little bit before he answers a lot of times. So I'm waiting for him to answer me, and he starts eating his food. And he's eating his food, and he's looking at me, and finally I'm going, hey, you know, what's the answer, Wayne? And he looks at me and he says, well, Jim, he says, I've thought about it, and there are three things that are most important to me in the world right now. He said, number one, I want to walk my daughter down the aisle at her wedding. Because I don't want to be in a wheelchair. I want to walk her down the aisle. And secondly, he said, I want to tell my wife, Leela, I love her every single time I see her until I go to be with the Lord. And he said, the third thing is, I want to tell the Lord Jesus I love him. Wayne has accomplished all three of those things that he wanted to do, okay? I asked him that day, I said, Wayne, I know where you're going and you know where you're going, but I have a friend who's lost. He's at second stage cancer, and he says he's an atheist. What do I say to that man? And he said, you just keep sharing the gospel with him. So that night I went to see my friend, and he's still active, but it's going to happen, okay? And I asked him the same question. I said, Dave, what's the most important thing to you in life right now? And you know what he said to me? He said, I want to accumulate as much stuff as I can. And it tore my heart out. And I went back to thinking what Wayne said. I said, that's it. Wayne knew what life is all about. It's all about loving others, loving your family, just like Rachel said, and loving the Lord Jesus Christ. It doesn't get any better than that. So I'm not going to stop with my friend. Wayne said, don't you stop. You pray for him every day and spend as much time with him, because one more soul in heaven is important. Leela, I thank you so much for allowing me to spend time with what I consider a great man. Wayne Yeargain was a great man who loved the Lord. And if there's anybody here that doesn't know the Lord, please talk with us, talk with Pastor Ron, because there's no better relationship than with a person who loves the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's for sure. Thank you, Leela. God bless.
Well, that was such a powerful word, powerful tribute to a life well lived. I want to take an opportunity on behalf of Leela and the family. If anybody at this time would like to come, just share a brief word of testimony of Wayne's impact on your life, please come up if you would, please. Thank you. Any others, you can come up now and just stand and kind of get ready as soon as he's done. You can come up.
Wayne was my friend. We were fishing buddies, so that made him real special. And we loved to fish together, and we loved to spend time together, and we loved to go to Bible study together, and we loved to share the Lord, and we loved the Lord. And we talked about how much we love our families and how important it is that we do that. Funny thing happened one day. We put a new carport at our house, and I came home from fishing, and I had my pole sticking up in the cart, and I forgot the cart was there, and I backed in, and I heard all these poles snapping and blah, blah, blah. Well, the next day we went fishing, and Wayne made his cast, and it worked real well, and the second cast, the rod broke. And he was all upset, and I wasn't going to tell him. He said, I'll pay you for it. I broke it, right? And I wasn't going to tell him, but then I couldn't let it go by, and I told him, and we got that straightened out. But, you know, we shared a lot of time together, and we didn't have to particularly say anything to one another. We just enjoyed one another's company. And we liked to do things together. And of course, he was offshore a lot, so we lost that time. But we prayed for one another every day. And I think the things that I learned through all of this is God's there all the time. All we have to do is reach out for him. And he listens to us. And he takes care of us, and he watches over us. I don't know why Wayne got cancer. I have cancer too. And fortunately, I just found out Thursday that my cancer's in remission. And I don't know how long that's going to last. But I remember Wayne called me up one day and said, "Guess what? We're twins. I got a port." And and I thought, boy, that's real thrilling, you know. But it was little things like that, that kept our spirits up, and we tried to encourage one another, and we tried to keep one another going through all this. And you know, life's not easy. I mean, you get certain things that come along. But one thing I've learned since I got diagnosed with cancer is what's important to us. And as Jimmy said, you know, there's only one thing that's truly important to me, and that's God. And the next thing is my wife and my family. And you know, and everything else is just stuff. And you know, once we get a grip on that if we stay close to the Lord, he'll take care of us and watch over us. And he's got Wayne right now, and Wayne's probably up there looking down laughing at us, because here we are grieving for him, and he's up there doing just great. And you know, all of us can be together with Wayne. And all of us meet at the same place with our Lord if we just let him come into our heart. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name's Bill Lucher, and that's my buddy Wayne. I've been coming here to Myrtle Grove about 6 years now, and I came in through the food pantry, and my mailing address was Little Patch of Woods on 65th and Lillian, and I've since, God has, you know, blessed me and made me to prosper, and I love this church. I love Wayne, Lila, Rachel, Daniel, Miss Hazel, Nelson, and just the family and all has blessed me. I'm one of those that I've never had a DUI, probably because I've never driven. and so Wayne, when I would need rides to the doctor's office, to the grocery store, to the emergency room when I was being stupid while doing that kind of stuff. Wayne was always there. He never said, "No, I can't. I got something to do." whatever, but he was always there for me. And he would at times exhort me, at times he would hold me accountable, which I needed to be and still do need to be. And he, Lita, and the whole family just been so blessed and dear to me. And it's, I get happy when I think that he's no longer, here with us. I should be sad, but I'm happy because I know where he's at. That's where we're going to. I love y'all. I love you. Thank you.
Being an ordained minister, I'm going to keep this brief because I know we all need to get out of here on time, right? The greatest memory that I had, my father-in-law, is I was playing kickball with my youth group, and this white-haired man came across the parking lot, and he looked at me, and he said, "Hi, my name is Wayne Yeargain, and you're dating my daughter." And I said, "Yes, sir." And he introduced himself, and he introduced his wife, my mother-in-law, and he said, "Let me take you for breakfast." And, as any good father would do, he questioned me, so many questions. And I really was relieved because it's the first time I had ever dated a girl that her father was so wanting to get to know the guy in that way. My second memory of him was coming down, and it was the day that I was proposing to Rachel. And I get down to Myrtle Grove Baptist Church. I have no idea where I'm going. I walk into a Sunday school room, and all these strapping men are telling me how much they love Rachel, how much she has so many uncles. He reminds me that his pocket knife is in his pocket. But as we go to Fort Pickens the day that I proposed to Rachel, we're riding in the car, and he looks at me and he says, "I have no idea what I'm doing." I said, "Good, I don't either." And we have this conversation, and he looks at me and he says, "Above all else, take care of my daughter. Love her." And it was the first time in a long, long time that I actually saw a man love his family so much. And that's just the type of guy he was. He loved and never wanted anything in return and would always give and give and give. And we were at his sister's house when his mother passed away. And he looked at me, and as we were leaving to go, he said, "She's yours now." And I didn't understand that at all at the time. I do now. And at the wedding, he said the same thing. "She's yours now." And I said, "Yes, sir." And he said, "Take good care of her." And I said, "I would." And the last time we were down here, he was in a hospital bed. It was the Saturday before Thanksgiving. And he woke up just long enough for Rachel to say goodbye. And I looked at him and shook his hand. And I had a feeling that it would be the last time, but I didn't want to believe that it was the last time. And as much as I would love to say I wish I had more time with him and could do more things, because Rachel's always telling me the memories, but the two things that I will take away from knowing him just over a year was he loved his family. He loved God. For anything. He loved people. No matter who you were, if you were a stranger, he still loved you. And I hope as I go in life that I can do the same things and be the type of man that he was and emulate who he was. And as my wife always reminds me, be like Daddy. You can do it. You can do it. So anyway, thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, stand for another song of praise and worship, and then we'll go into our message of hope. Beautiful, beautiful.
You would just sing this verse with me before we start this next song. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever, my Lord, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. By now they fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never faithfulness, your faithfulness.
the still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. Oh, this is my confidence. You've never failed me, yeah.
Thank you, gentlemen. God bless you. You may be seated. You know, so much has been shared already. I don't need to go long. But just two closing thoughts about Wayne's life that struck me here the last few days as I was looking through the Word of God. One was found right here in the book of Ephesians in chapter 4. If Wayne wasn't aware of this passage, he certainly lived it out in his life. In verse 25 and following, it says, put away lying, speak the truth, each one of you to his neighbor, because we are members of one another. Be angry, but don't sin. And don't let the sun go down in your anger. Don't give the devil an opportunity. The thief must no longer steal. Instead, must do honest work with his own hands so that he has something to share with those in need. No foul language is to come out of your mouth, but only what is good for building each other up. So that it gives grace to those who hear. And do not grieve God's Holy Spirit, for you are sealed with Him for the day of redemption. One of the things that was real clear with Wayne's life is he spoke the truth and he served God with his hands. He served in many other ways, but many of us will know how he served with his deeds and doing. I went over to visit one day, and this is after Wayne was diagnosed, and he was struggling, feeling the effects of the cancer, and he said, I'm going to paint the inside of this house. I've been to a lot of people who get diagnosed with cancer, and that was the first time I heard anyone say, I think I'm going to paint this house, and he did. Beautiful job, painted the inside of his house. Not to mention the fact that every day there was a work day, that man would be right over here, even when he was struggling and physically hurting with the effects of the cancer in his body. He would come over here and paint all the trim. On work day, he was the first one who showed up. If he was in town, even when he was working offshore, if he was in town, the man would be here at his church, one of the first ones to respond to any need that was around here on the campus where he could work and serve God with his hands. I believe that your husband had the spiritual gift of service and helps. Every one of us have a gift. He used that gift. Among other things that he had, he used that gift so effectively. Tony McFarlane. Tony couldn't be here because he's out of town, but he loved Wayne. He told me on the phone, when I would call Tony, you know, when I left, they continued a group of men to pray every Tuesday morning early on Tuesday at 6 a.m. Gather right over here in the office. Even while, I mean just a few weeks before, Wayne would leave this planet to be with the Lord. I was on the phone with Tony, said, man, Wayne showed up. He was here right after his daughter's wedding. Right there, Tuesday morning, with that prayer group. Johnny, I know some of you guys that attend that prayer group. You saw him. Paul, that's a Marine, right? A Marine for Jesus. A Marine for Jesus. One other thought. I read earlier, Romans, out of the book of Romans, that victory passage that the Apostle Paul penned. But if you go back to verse 28, Paul makes a statement, one of the most well-loved quoted verses in all the Bible. We know that in all things work together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to His purpose. Now, for a lost man and woman, when you quote that, they say, what do you mean works for the good? What's so good about someone being taken home early from this planet and having to leave his family? What's good about that? You know, folks, over the years that I've pastored churches and did homegoings just like this for great men just like Wayne, because we don't understand doesn't mean that it's not understandable. Did you hear that? Because in our finite minds, we may never be able to answer questions, the question why. But as long as we have the confidence in the where, Wayne said, it takes the, what did Paul say? It takes the sting out of death. Paul said, O death, where is thy sting? Where's the sting? O grave, where is your victory? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. The victory is ours in the Lord Jesus. Give him praise and glory. Amen? We can thank God for that. And when we say we know that we know that we know that we know, deep in our heart, we're going to see our brother again, your son, your husband, you know, your daddy, your brother, that we're going to see him again. That's not wishful thinking. That we can stand on the solid rock of the Word of God. That's the sustaining power for the believer. Not just now. It's been that way since the beginning. Over 2,000 years ago when our Savior said, in this world you'll have trouble, but take heart, for I have overcome the world. And he told Martha at the funeral service for her brother Lazarus, Martha, do you believe? Do you believe I can raise your that your brother will rise again? She said, Lord, I believe that you are the eternal Son of God. Jesus said, for those who believe in me, though they die, so shall they live again. And those who trust in me will never die. Eternal life begins on the moment we say, Jesus, come into my heart. Be my Savior and Lord. At that very moment, we have eternal life. Death is only a bump of the road, friend. It's a door that leads us right to the Savior, Jesus. And for that, we can praise God. For that, we can have a celebration of life and rejoice because we know that nothing can separate us. What did it say? I read it earlier. There in the closing verses of chapter 8, Paul said, for I am persuaded, I am convinced that neither death nor life nor angels or demons, neither the past nor the present nor any other thing in the whole world, the universe, will ever be able to separate me from Jesus Christ, from the love of God in my Lord Jesus. Give him glory today, friend. Give him glory. If you're a believer, you know, just, I mean, you know, we can entertain the thought that Wayne's talking to your daddy right now. Hey, what'd you think about that, Dad? Well, I'll tell you that, Leela, I don't know. I mean, we can imagine what our sanctified imaginations, what's that going to be like when you see the people that you love that went on to heaven and you see them again? I know things are going to be different up there, but man, let me tell you something, it's going to be glorious. Our finite minds can't even comprehend what that's going to look like. But if you ask me, dear friend, do I believe it? I believe it with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength, just like I love my Lord God, and like you all love your Lord God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. We can trust him. No matter what comes, there's going to be tough times. Jesus didn't kind of throw any surprises at us. Remember, our Lord said, in this world you will have trouble. The rain will fall on the just and the unjust. But always remember what takes the sting out of death is the glorious assurance of eternal life in Christ our Lord. At this time, Gloria Young's going to come, and he's going to close out with a song and then a prayer after that, and then a time of celebration in our Family Life Center. Gloria.
can fly higher than the eagle. 'Cause you are the wind beneath my wings. It might have appeared to go to be.
Ladies and gentlemen, family, church family, stand if you would, please. Right before I pray, on behalf of this family, I'd like to invite you to the Bayview Cemetery at 4 p.m. There will be a brief closure there and ceremony at the graveside, and that will be at 4 p.m. at Bayview. And, of course, right after this prayer, we'll have a continuation of the celebration of Wayne's life in our Family Life Center. And you're all invited to join us at that time. Let's go ahead and reach out, if you would, please. Take a hand of a family friend, church member next to you right now. Oh, Lord, glory be your name. All praise, honor, and glory to you. Lord, for your servant Wayne, for his life, his impact, his legacy, we give you thanks this day, Jesus, for such a great salvation that allows us to leave this planet with such a sense of completeness and glory. Father, like Paul, Wayne could say that he ran the race, finished the race, completed the job. And now he's enjoying the favor of the great reward that comes to him and to all of us who have placed our trust in you. Bless this dear family, extended family, church family, friends that are here. May we never forget of a life well lived here this side of heaven by Wayne Yeargain. And Father, may we strive to have a life pleasing before you. In your sight, in Jesus' name, bless the food now and the time of celebration that we'll enjoy here in the hour after. In the name of your Son, amen. Amen. Bless you.